Dr. Meera Bandur, we have with us today. Thank you, Meera, for joining us today. And we would like, we started this dialogue series with CWPI. We started this as a small collective for women philosophers in India, and essentially trying to first see whether or not if address of gender gap, firstly, if there is any within the Indian philosophical domain. And through our dialogue with you, perhaps we'll probably touch on some of those themes, as well as some related themes of being a philosopher, a practicing philosopher in the academia, as well as a public philosopher. I mean, Dr. Meera needs no introduction. I mean, she's a seasoned academic with various publications to her name, and with research interests belonging to areas of Indian philosophy, environmental philosophy, ethics, and sustainability. Apart from her role as an associate professor at Manipal University, Jaipur, she's also engaged in a lot of public activities, such as being the editor of The Barefoot Philosophers. That's how I also kind of interact with her beyond my primary role in Jinder, as well as the ethics expert at the globalethics.net, right? And what's also interesting is you also have a blog under your belt on the YouTube channel for Indian philosophy, specifically called The Mistress of Philosophy. And I know we had that discussion previously regarding the terminology or the name of the channel itself, which is quite, in our conversation, we might touch upon that as well, because that's related to what we want to address as well, The Mistress of Philosophy. So thank you, Meera, for coming on board. And so just to kind of start off the discussion, I think we'll let's have it a much more conversationalist style. What would you think? And I think we've had this discussion with previous philosophers as well. What was it for you? How did you end up choosing this discipline of philosophy, the so-called discipline, or was it vice versa for you? Did it naturally come to you, or was it something you had to seek out on your own?
So philosophy came to me because I was born in a privileged Brahmin family. And so there's a lot of Sanskrit and Vedas and Ramayana and Mahabharata going on, right? So the entry to philosophy particularly is through Indian philosophy. But I think it came to me through my mother. My mother was an MA in Sanskrit and MA in philosophy, right? And like all typical youngsters of my generation, in my community, we were all encouraged to do science, and we were supposed to do engineering or medicine or MSc physics or whatever, right? My father was a scientist. He ran the Vishveshwarya Science Museum. Mother was a philosopher. So I guess I ended up as a philosophy of science, though I didn't see it at that way, that time. So philosophy came to me through Chinmaya Mission, right? Reading Advaita, Bhagavad Gita, Upanishads, all that, doing the pravachans. It was more intellectual. It was not like the satsangs and the jagratas of the north. It was more an intellectual, like, you know, teaching of scriptures and commentaries on the Bhagavad Gita and all that. So Indian philosophy in the sense of the spirituality came to me quite early. So my introduction to philosophy is probably the layperson's understanding of philosophy, a way to reach God or moksha or something, right? So my mother started studying, it's very strange. My mother started studying her master's in philosophy when I was in my third year degree, right? And she was like handling us, three kids, and then a small adjunct job as a Sanskrit teacher. And then she was trying to fill up forms and do exams. And so there was an urgency for her to do an exam. And she said, go read these books, summarize it for me and bring the main points. So I went to British Council, opened this history of Western philosophy. And then I saw this, she wanted me to look at Moore on Good. Okay, so I didn't know what this was. And I started reading it and I realized, oh God, this is a completely different way of looking at philosophy. And then I started to summarize her notes for us and I'd make these little answers for her to study. So in some sense, my mother's MA philosophy portions came to me, and I actually understood that philosophy is much vaster than just the Bhagavad Gita or the Upanishads or thing. And I think But I was not really, you know, it was like something like a hobby. It was not like a professional choice at that time. And then when I did then I started looking for nature, because environment was always my first love. I always wanted to be like Jane Goodall and go and live with chimpanzees. So as I started doing environmental science and studies with nature and human sustainability and all those kind of things, I think I naturally moved towards like, how can you change people's mind about the environment? And then studied eco-psychology. So I did my master's in psychology. And then I suddenly realized that all these people are actually drawing from a greater discipline. There's like something behind psychology, something behind this. And that's conceptualizations. And so I said, people's consciousness has to transform. If their inner self is transformed, then they will be like, they will be one with the world, and then they'll be kinder to nature also, and they'll be like, we'll save the world and the planet and all that. So there was a kind of a very strong feeling that psychology and lectures and awareness was not enough. And that's when I met Dr. Sundar Sarkar, my mentor, and then suddenly it was like, you know, little bit of leak, and suddenly there's a torrent. And then there's like, I suddenly saw all these people who had never heard before, Kant and Locke and Hume and Heidegger and Husserl and all these other Western philosophers. And even in Indian philosophy, I suddenly was introduced to these hundreds and thousands of Indian philosophers who were different. So my 5 years at National Institute of Advanced Studies with Dr. Sundar have been like the most formative years of academic philosophy study, right? I got exposed to the whole. And after that, there's been no looking back. I suddenly see philosophy as a discipline that underlies everything. And I always tell my students also, the P in the PhD is philosophy.
Yeah.
So everybody who does a PhD has to do philosophy, whether they like it or not. Right?
No wonder it's called the doctor of philosophy.
Yeah, and Dr. Bendu, just to take it from there, personally, as a philosopher, what is philosophy for you? I mean, you did mention initially a bit about spiritualism and how there has to be a distraction or a tension between philosophy and spiritualism, because largely in Indian public domain, when we talk about Indian philosophy, even when you Google certain things on YouTube, the first few videos are going to be of some sadhus or some so-called people who are telling us, get moksha, this is what philosophy is, it's about karma. And largely that is also getting interpreted or reinterpreted by the West, maybe because it suits them, whatever it is. But as a philosopher who practices in India, what is philosophy for you? How do you define philosophy?
So I prefer a very broad definition of philosophy, a kind of elastic definition of philosophy. For me, philosophy is conceptual thinking, abstract thinking, right? So it is nothing but thinking in a particular way. You can think about things and objects, and you can think about a descriptive or a representative thing about things in the world. I can just think, oh, the Zoom meeting has got how my screen is looking, and is there too much light on the right side? I can think a lot of things about things. I'm thinking all the time. So for me, philosophy, in Indian philosophy, you have to stop thinking in order to get moksha. So the knowledge that you need to stop thinking is actually the thinking of philosophy, which also doesn't seem very broad, because it is, if you don't want to get moksha, then are you not doing philosophy, right? And there's also this other elitist idea of philosophy, like philosophy is about studying other philosophers who call themselves philosophers, right? So if you study somebody, like I remember reading that one of our Hannah Arendt saying, don't call me a philosopher, I don't want to be a philosopher, right? So there is a certain association of philosophy with certain kinds of paradigms, stereotypes. But for me, philosophy personally is thinking, and thinking abstractly, thinking about the, not about the context or the content, but thinking about the concept. What conceptualization is abstraction. You know, you can have a pen, and the pen is a pen as an object, and you're thinking about the pen as a pen. Supposing you decide the pen is a murder weapon, there's something that you're doing from jumping from murder weapon to the pen. Sorry for this strange example, but I think it'll stay in people's head, right? So when you decide the pen is a weapon, or the pen is something you're going to dig the ground with, or the pen is something that you're going to scratch your hair with, then you're doing something to the pen which is beyond what it suggests to you. You're abstracting the pen into a concept called a tool, and then you're abstracting it further into its various different functions. It's only possible if you stop thinking about the pen as a pen and think of it as a concept. You can change the concept that belongs to it. Concept of a writing tool versus concept of a scratching tool or a murdering tool, right? Yeah. So the conceptualization, that shift, that jump from what's there to what's behind, or what is the presupposition of it, or what's the background of it, that I think for me is philosophy. And that's possible in any circumstance. People are always doing it. They just don't recognize that that's philosophical thinking.
Yeah. Thank you for that illustration. I mean, that's definitely going to stick around. And it's interesting to see that, you know, it's not necessarily reading up of certain text or authors per se, or Western or Indian philosophy, but it's the style or the way of thinking or conceptualizing, rationalizing. And then how do you present what is it that you're thinking, and how is it that the shift that you had in your thing? And I think that's definitely going to be a thing for people to understand when they kind of equate or confuse rather philosophy with very other softer forms of disciplines of philosophy. Like many people tend to equate Indian philosophy with just spiritualism. Like that's it, for period, yeah. Full stop. And I think it's important for people to understand that shift or in terms of the academic pursuit of philosophy, as well as, you know, just the public philosophy, or what is it that philosophers do, really. So it's it just may seem like they're not just sitting and thinking. Thinking is an activity that they're doing, right? So from that, I would also like to take you on through, yes, I know philosophy is not necessarily about just studying of texts or authors, but of course, while in your pursuit of academic philosophy, we do end up reading lots of scholars and authors. So amongst, in your journey or your experience of them, can you probably highlight or probably mention which were a few philosophers who have perhaps impacted your journey or your thinking in a significant way? And if out of them, there have been some female philosophers particularly who have impacted your thinking?
Okay, so given that my definition of philosophy is quite large, let me say there are intellectual people whom I've read who have impacted me. And you're right. When you say academic philosophy, I would like to say that academic philosophy and spiritual philosophy are not that different. The problem is people who are doing spiritual philosophy are not doing philosophy. They're just listening to other people and following what they're saying. They're basically, what do you call it? They're compliant to other philosophers. They're not doing the thinking themselves. They're being spoon-fed the philosophy.
So the person actually... Is it the obedience factor, like the belief in the faith?
It's the obedience factor, yeah. So when somebody is telling you, when some big, you know, I won't take names here, but when some big Swamiji says it's better for women to be married young so that they get used to the family they're going to be married in, everybody accepts it on authority. So authority is the problem there, not philosophy. If somebody's actually sat and thought about the whole thing and then came up with their own, you know, like Buddha says, Appo Dipo Bhava, be your own light. Even if you're doing spirituality, people are just, you know, Swamiji will stand there and say, close your eyes and you will all see blue light. And it's like the emperor's new clothes. Everybody's like, I'm seeing blue light. I'm floating 5 inches above the ground. I felt so good. It's just a repetition. It's not an actual conceptualization.
But I'm sorry to like cut you in between, but just a thought came to my mind, and I thought of sharing it with you, that this it's a very interesting concept of obedience that you're bringing into philosophy, but don't you think it actually lies in contradiction to Indian tradition? Like, we have rich tradition of Shastrarth, where the basis of teaching was debate, that you don't have to get convinced, it's not my way or highway. But now I think, I don't know who is to be blamed, whether it's the fact that the way Nietzsche talked about herd morality, or mass morality, that there would be a time that we would need instant Maggie noodle solution. Like, what's the reason that people are getting their PhDs and MPhil on WhatsApp University, or everybody's thinking that Twitter is the new battleground where every solution, every problem would get solved? It's precisely, I don't know, maybe because, of course, one, it's a very interesting point about obedience which you raise. And the second, maybe it could be because we really don't have the will, the patience to read. And maybe we are running to, we'll do everything, but we'll not think. And that's why when the first wave happened and the lockdown happened, I remember I was reading articles during 2-3 weeks, everybody was like, oh, we are playing Ludo, we are doing Netflix and chill and Amazon and everything. And after 3-4 weeks, people started getting burned out, because how much are you going to consume? How much Netflix and chill are you going to do? And bam, you are confronted with thinking that, oh shit, I am living with my family, I am living by myself, what is going to happen? So do you think it also has to do with certain kind of times in which we are living? Or is it just the general perception of how philosophy is getting practiced in India?
I think it's every time had non-thinkers, okay? Every time, it's not that during the age of the Indian philosophers, everyone was doing philosophy. But what happened was those people who were thinking were respected, and people listened to people who were thinking. People checked out. You know, we have something called apta pramana in Sankhya philosophy, which means the appropriate authority, right? So before I take, even Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, who's known as a very good thing, told Vivekananda, test me before you take me as your teacher. Right? And before we join a university, we check whether the university has accreditation. But somehow with this Gurudam and Guruji philosophy, we don't check the accreditation of those people, right? It's like fashion, right? Everybody wants to suddenly start wearing like low-rise jeans. Are you with this crowd of cool people who say Hari Om instead of saying hi? So everyone is like Hari Om Hari. Don't even know what is Hari, don't know what is home, but it becomes an identity. So it's a cultish kind of feeling. I guess it's just a psychology of trying to be. And you're right, people are lazy about thinking, because thinking confronts, before you think about other things, thinking confronts your own self. And that process, if you're not stoic enough, you can really break down. And it is okay to listen to people, but if you're not, there's Shravan which is happening. In our own Indian philosophy, we say Shravan, but Manan is not happening. Thinking is not happening. And after Manan, the other point, which is Nididhyasana, which academic philosophers do, is not happening. But coming back to Mansi's point, because it's not just conceptualization happens within language. And I believe language or vak or speech, not necessarily written language, speech or articulation is a very deep part of philosophy. So whether you listen to philosophy or whether you read philosophy, the words, the language is important. And that's where for me, I got confronted by the language of English, the language of Sanskrit, the language of Kannada, the language of Tamil. Being multilingual allowed me to see the nuances of philosophy in different texts. So if you want to talk about women philosophers whose texts I really love and I keep going back, one is the set of all the bhakti poets, right? Akka Mahadevi, for instance, when I read the poetry, for me, most of philosophers who, men philosophers, write about the mind, about all these abstract conceptual world concepts. But I'm very interested in the body experience. So for me, I got pulled towards, because my, you know, you can't, as a woman, you can't ignore your body. Even for, if you keep quiet for 27 days, on the 28th day, it will pull you down into the wash basin. Like, you know, you have to, it pulls you down. You have migraine, you have PMS, you have this, you have menopause, you have reproductive problems, you have cramps. So you can't be without, you can't just go like floating away. You can't be a mind in a box. You're box in a mind. Okay? Like, the body is always there. And so I got drawn and I saw women philosophers articulating the body very well. So Akka Mahadevi's poems for me are about body and desire and love and romance. They're very beautiful. And they're written in Kannada. Her texts are really, I think more work needs to be done. They reduce women bhakti poetry to boyfriend, girlfriend, you know, paradigm. you know, like when Meera sings to Krishna, they reduce her to a husband-wife paradigm or a lover paradigm. They're not able to see the philosophy behind it. So you would have Ranja and Hill doing the same thing that Meera and Krishna did in her life, right? So I feel that's a kind of, as if women are not capable of abstract, conceptual, political thinking. So bhakti poets are one place. I need to do a lot of work. Theri Gatha is another text, which is very interesting. So these two texts really influenced. So I was like really upset with women, lack of women philosophers, because there's one Gargi and one Maitri. They don't say anything. Basically, they're listening to other people. And then there's Sulabha, who comes up in the Mahabharata and says one paragraph. Okay, how much can you theorize on that one paragraph, right? So they're not given a stage to speak. I don't think they never spoke. I think they spoke, but I don't think they're given a stage to speak. So then I was really frustrated. And then suddenly I came across this book that was coming out, which is Karen Warren's project. Karen Warren writes this text called An Unconventional History of Philosophy. And it's a wonderful book, Unconventional History of Western Philosophy, amazing book. She looks at all the men philosophers and sees that all their girlfriends and their wives and their co-friends have been corresponding to them, to the philosophers. So Locke has a person who's writing to him. Kant has a person who's
there's
writing
Beauvoir to him.
Kant has this woman, I think.
Yeah. There's also Simone Sartre.
Yeah, they're corresponding. And so she pulls out all these correspondences and publishes them and shows us how monad was not a concept developed by a male white philosopher. It was suggested by his girlfriend, right? And then you suddenly realize that. So everywhere you start to see that. So it is quite possible that the amazing example of smoke and the fire in Indian philosophy, which we keep talking about, wherever there is smoke, there is fire, was probably suggested to the sage by his wife.
So we've touched upon, thank you for bringing that up, like we've kind of come towards that area that we did want to touch upon, that, you know, it's probably not that women weren't thinking or they didn't have ideas or ways to put forth what they were experiencing, right? It's probably they just didn't have enough representation or the stage to do so. And like you mentioned, and I think I've had this discussion previously with Richa at some point also, women were part of the dialogue or the debate or the discussion happening behind the scenes at least. So maybe we may not have read scholarly text while we were growing up per se, like in a academic pursuit, but whosoever's male philosopher's text we read, women may have contributed in some sense to their thinking at least. And perhaps with people like you or us and maybe some others now, you know, people will try to come up with ways of looking back at how is it that women perhaps contributed towards the development of philosophical thought as well. So, even if they were not necessarily practicing philosophers or public philosophers, they had domestic households to take care of. Thinking can still be done in the domains of a household, right? So, I think from there, I would like to come towards the question, like there is in some sense a slight underrepresentation, slight in some sense of at least in that with respect to gender. Do you also think there's also some issue with representation with respect to geographical locations in terms of do we have a whitewashed sense of philosophy or academia broadly? In India, at least. What do you have to say about that?
So most of the time, what happens, what I'm now realizing in my younger philosophy, I was like just upset with people not doing Indian philosophy and using Indian conceptualizations and why aren't you using Indian? And then I suddenly realized that it's like this, right? Philosophers themselves do Indian philosophy, but they prefer to compartmentalize it, right? So there's Western philosophy that's very clear. So when I'm talking, for example, one of my students yesterday was saying, so he was talking about Dravya, which is the Indian word for substance. And I was saying, how is Dravya related to Aristotle's substance? Is it the same or not? Such a question will not be entertained in class, because Aristotle's form and substance is completely different. Dravya is completely different. So they will compartmentalize it so much, those two are immiscible. Right? There's no, because Indian philosophy has to say pure and Indian and Sanskrit and upper caste or privileged, and this Western philosophy. And also the when other people like sociologists and all take philosophy to explain their ideas, the finishing on Western philosophy is nicer. Perhaps because we are whitewashed, right? Yeah. We feel that it's nicer to, because the conceptualizations in Indian philosophy haven't been studied. There's lots of commentary, translations are not available. So when you look at something, people are just so ignorant about the depth of the conceptualizations of Indian terms, right? So I just wrote this word, for example, upeksha. Upeksha in Sanskrit, or upikka in Buddhism, means ignoring or not paying attention to. So the way people understand upeksha is that you are this sannyasi and you don't want to look at the desire, you ignore it, right? So it's a very Buddhist, like moksha-oriented, nirvana, nibbana-oriented idea. So when I was looking at the idea of upeksha, I suddenly realized that upeksha is a form of dissent. If you want to be Gandhiji and you want to pick up salt on the road, you have to upeksha the law, salt law. You have to ignore the salt law in order to break it. So when you are in a protest or you're saying you're dissenting from something, you are ignoring the norm. So upeksha is actually a dissent term. Now imagine if you started interpreting, Romila has written a beautiful book on dissent right now. And as I was reading it, I was seeing upeksha everywhere. But the word upeksha has not been treated or talked about before I started working with this best way and writing a paper about it. People have not played with these terms. And then the problem is also in Indian philosophy, they have a lot of authoritarian copyright. I call it the Sanskritic copyright. So the first time I say something, like I try and misinterpret or play with a word, yeah. I can do that in Western philosophy. Kant is not going to come and kill me. But if I play around with terms like Advaita or Brahman or Upeksha or Vimati, not only the Indian scholars, the pundits, not only the Indian academics, even the Western academics who study Indian philosophy will come and yell at you. My first shock was, I know to write Sanskrit, but in my traditional training, I had not got training of diacritical marks in Sanskrit. I don't know how to write Sanskrit in English. So I did my paper, I did my thesis, and I did my diacritical marks, but you know, when you're writing in English, the THA, TA, the TA apostrophe, you're not a Sanskritist, so you're not very careful. But my spellings in Sanskrit are very correct, because I've learned Sanskrit as a tradition. So the first thing this guy says to me, my thesis reviewer says to me, very famous Western Indian Indologist says to me, is that this thesis is completely like bunkum, because she can't even spell Sanskrit words properly. I was like so upset. In fact, that only pushed me over to like the Mistress of Philosophy. Because you are here, and the problem is not only whitewashing, the problem is Indian texts themselves have been, you know, fateh chada diye hamare text pe. They have been collected by the Westerners, and now they determine what is right in Indian philosophy. It's also a kind of colonial colonization of our text. It's not the way Max Muller did and made us exhausting. It's like if I have to now refer to Sankhya, the first name I would have to refer to is Greg Gerald Larson. I can't refer to Sri Sri or anybody in India.
But like you were mentioning, there's also this authority attached with Indian philosophy, which is generated within India as well as from the Western world as well. Could it be perhaps because Indian philosophy, so the traditional schools of Indian philosophy are more or less the religious schools, you know, and that's why, you know, the place of religion in our society somewhat comes with a sense of authority.
I think it is casteist. More than religion, it is casteist. It's from the privileged caste. And so you have Buddhism and Pali and Jainism breaking through those bonds. But even there, what happens is authority becomes the spiritual man, like the Guruji. So mathas and all those start to become, in a way, they, we can't regret them because they are what kept these texts alive. If it were not for the mathas, we wouldn't even have those philosophies. I mean, we can't retrogradely go and blame them back and say, why didn't you have Dalit philosophy? But what we can do is right now, we don't have to, we can take those texts and we can also ask Dalits to philosophize, right? But we, if we continue the same kind of way, that's a problem. So I think religion has played a huge role, but it in the earlier phases of philosophy, philosophical thinking, which was like debate, was more of a literary tradition. It was not a religious tradition because it was a court tradition. Like, you know, you could say it's like an earlier form of Qawwali, right? So you would go and present before the king and you'd have, it was like a, it was a recreational activity of intellectual debating.
Yeah.
Right? So you would use that as a privileged elitist debate competition between philosophies. And of course, if the king gave you money, you had more money. I guess it was very expensive to create ink and get manuscripts prepared. I guess the library costs in those days were also very high.
So hopefully we should have that practice continuing in the literary form.
We should.
Go ahead, Richa.
I was just wondering, I think I just have a curiosity more from an epistemological sphere. And right now, when you actually, when you brought in the idea of mathas and all these people who could also be seen as a carrier, who have, if no, we can debate about how they have outlived or lived or carried on philosophy, but they have definitely played a role in preserving it. Now, when we talk about preservation or when we talk about bodies as carriers who are transmitting or who are transferring philosophy, do you think that traditionally, as well as right now in the contemporary times, has there been a distrust that certain kind of philosophical voices would be considered authentic, would be considered philosophical enough to be engaged with? Like, I remember for the first time when I started teaching, and when I started, even though the idea of being called as a philosopher could be very overwhelming, but still the fact that you are getting trained to be a philosopher, and when you tell your students that, okay, I'm a philosopher, many a times the first feedback which I've got is, you don't look like a philosopher. And that made me think, okay, then I started thinking the professors who have taught me in JNU and other places that, of course, they have been men as well. But is it the general way of that we have boxes, that there are four tick box of who can be considered as a philosophical voice? And it's very closely related to, can I trust you as an epistemological agent? There could be multiple factors, having beard, age, looking, being lost. Like one day I was talking to my uncle and he said, you really don't look like a philosopher, no beard, no jeans. And I'm like, what are you talking? Do you hear yourself? Are you not making sense? But then that's his idea, because that's how he has perceived philosophy, because he thinks that, you know, these are intellectuals and they aren't into the worldly things. So do you think that even right now, is this a reason that there is a strong relationship between whom do we trust as a philosophical voice and whom we do not? And that is in a way related to epistemology.
Yeah, it is very true. This I've experienced again and again, because, you know, when, me and my mentor, Dr. Sundar Sarukai, have started speaking in the same forums, many, many places we are invited together. So his bio will read like, Dr. Sundar Sarukai is a philosopher, blah, blah, blah. And my bio will always read, even if I send a wrong bio, it'll always read, Meera Bandur is teaching philosophy at, right? I forcibly will write, Meera Bandur is a philosopher teaching at Manipal University. But it'll never be Meera Bandur is a philosopher teaching. It'll always be Meera Bandur teaches philosophy. So there's this, I started to notice this thing as you, as, you know, you, in the beginning, you're a student, you're first of all a PhD student, so you have a very low sense of self-esteem. And then you have people all around you and you read Heidegger and Nietzsche and you're like, I'll never be like them. And you're like totally lost. But slowly you develop confidence, suddenly start realizing that I'm good. I'm publishing. It's so common that in one class, you won't believe it. I was sitting in the class, it was a first BA class. I said something and the students started arguing with me in a very rude way. Like he would argue with his mother in the house for some doing chores, right? I literally banged on I stormed out of the classroom. A very funny reaction I had to that. He said something like, it was like, ah, come on. You know, you don't tell that to your professor who's taught for 7 years and had 3 PhD students. You don't say that. Oh, come on. That's just a big shit. Okay. So I'm like, this is not done. I'm doing philosophy here. I'm a professor and I'm telling you, and you can't get away with that kind of, you know, argument where you're not even logical. So I went and came back and dumped all my books on the table, the ones I'd written. And I said, when you write all these books, then you come and talk back to me. You think I'm here doing the cooking? And I said that very harshly. I said, do you think I'm having a karchi here and doing like serving you rasam or what? Then I went back and I came back and said, even the person who serves karchi and rasam should be respected for what they do. Now, I don't think, you know, it's like the authority doesn't lie just in us. It's a gendered world. And unless you fit into the stereotype of a philosopher, that's why in Mistress of Philosophy, I begin with that. It's like Legally Blonde. You know, we are all living that life. You know, if you have lipstick, you are not having philosophy. If you are not quirky, you don't have philosophy. Or if you are cooperative, if you're not aggressive, you're not philosophy. In fact, if you are passionately talking like me, you're not doing philosophy. You have to be like, you know, I have to talk about philosophy in this really boring way, where only my words will convey the meaning and not my voice. My passion has to be absolutely flat.
Yeah, and that I was actually very objective manner. Like, you can't have expressions when you talk. I really don't understand this infatuation that, I mean, to be very honest, we are philosophers and we are also performers.
Yeah.
Like the very fact that, aren't you like too expressive? I'm like, what is that supposed to mean? Like, what do you want me to do? Should I just sit on a like higher sofa or something and like give you a pravachan? Would that
flat
make
face.
Flat
and,
face.
Like, philosophy doesn't need to be dispassionate. One doesn't need to be dispassionate to pursue philosophy.
And it's like, you know, this even I doubt whether Buddha and Jesus and all of them would have been like this calm person who's taught. I'm sure they would have gotten into fights and, you know, being really like active people. I guess it's a kind of a stereotype that comes from a kind of associating power and royalty. It's a power play. It's basically a power play. And the stereotyping is also a power play. So you would even find that even women students, when you teach them, they would go back to a male professor to check if you haven't still got to that point. When you have like students and you tell something like a PhD student something in class, they quietly go behind your back and talk to the male professors and make sure what you've said. So this is a kind of cross. They will cross check what you say with the Google or with the thing. It is not their fault. It is just it's so much in the atmosphere, the distrust of women's words, right? Women's words are not trusted. We are supposed to be emotional and we are supposed to be liars. We're supposed to cheat. Our sexuality and our PMS and our emotions come in the way. I mean, I want to actually theorize PMS. I would like to do philosophy when I'm having my PMS periods. So I can actually, maybe there's a different kind of philosophy that'll come out when you're having PMS. Yeah. So how can you theorize anger if you don't know how anger is?
Hmm. Yeah, I mean, that also, like, this was one example which I gave to my students this semester when we were doing a section on gender and mistrust. When I asked them that, do you remember from your childhood when you guys used to come back from school and when your mother used to be really back with you that, hey, start working, start to do your homework. And he's like, yeah, yeah, fine, I'll do it. Tomorrow I'll do it, day after tomorrow. And the moment our mom used to say that, see, let your dad come today. I'll speak to him. Immediately, I mean, I have no shame in admitting I have done it in my childhood. That the very moment when my mother used to say, see, let your father come, we'll have a talk with him today. I don't know, something used to happen to me. And I used to think that, oh my God, now my dad has known all this, I'm going to be in trouble. So the idea of course, taking gendered voices as something with whom we can bargain. मतलब चलता है, ठीक है, मम्मी बोल रही है, बोलने दो, क्या कर लेगी इससे ज्यादा, उससे ज्यादा तो कुछ नहीं कर सकती, उसका काम तो किचन में है. बट मेरे डैड को अगर पता चल गया, मेल अथॉरिटीज को अगर मैं पता चल गया, तब तो आई बी इन ट्रबल. उनके साथ बागेन नहीं कर सकते. एंड अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग एग्जाम्पल विच यू गेव दैट एट टाइम्स इट ऑल्सो हैपन्स इन क्लास दैट व्हेन यू आर टीचिंग अ क्लास विच हैज इट्स सो डाइवर्स देयर इज अ पॉसिबिलिटी एंड इट हैज हैपन्ड दैट द स्टूडेंट्स वुड गो बैक to a male professor and they'll cross check which of a female faculty, a female philosopher has taught you. So the fact of mistrust and gender and also distrust and gender, like cross check kar lete yaar, pata nahi. And also, I mean, I think I really liked your point when you said that the idea of PMSing and everything. Now, I mean, theek hai, people have been thanking internet and popular culture for making these terms normal, but they have become normal in a very weird manner. For instance, so many times I've heard things like, oh God, why are you so cranky? Are you PMSing? And I'm like, I'm not PMSing. I'm really angry with what you're doing right now.
So even our emotions are not given. We don't have the authority over our own emotions.
Or
PMS
our experience
has to make us cranky. You know,
yeah. Yeah. It's why like, are you so cranky? Oh God, you want ice cream? I don't want ice cream. Don't irritate me. Got to like see. It has nothing to do with PMSing. Like I'm professional enough to like go in a class and keep a good face even when I'm PMSing. We have done it so many times.
Yeah. I mean,
but
it'll be
I
interesting
think it's common
to see.
Across academics, right? It's common across academics. In philosophy, it becomes even more of a problem because philosophy is this subject which is supposed to be about intellectual thinking. Right, I've not seen this happen so much in literature, so much in science. Of course, there's already an absence of philosophers, but more or less the subject is an authority. But I think in philosophy what happens is the authority comes from the epistemic agent, right? We are the commentators, so I think there's where our question, our authority is continuously questioned.
And
yeah, go ahead, Mansi.
Yeah, and the conditioning that we'd already been given and the environment that we've been in, that plays a huge role in how we then perhaps behave around in those settings. For instance, even in a classroom when we begin to question those agents themselves, right? I think with your this theme, you mentioned this notion of power play in terms of a dialogue, you know, while you're having a conversation or a discussion. A particular agent may occupy a seat, a certain powerful position. And then I want to take that on with the field of science, like you just mentioned, you know, science itself as a subject or a discipline is authoritative. It also is, comes with a certain notion of power, right? And I think in recent times, such as the pandemic happening, most of us can agree how much we're looking up to science or scientists. What do they have to say? What do they have to guide us or advise us on with the pandemic? While on the other hand, there's something to do with morality when the entire human race is kind of facing something like the pandemic. What would you think is the role or the connection between how is it should science perhaps interact with morality? Should science be moral or should it be under the supervision of some morality? Or what are your thoughts on that?
See, science is not done by robots. Science is done by human beings, right? So human beings have to be moral, simple. You first be moral and then you do science. Then your science also will have morality. If you're doing immoral, if you are immoral and you do science, you're going to do immoral science,
immoral
right?
Science.
If you're Nazi Germany, you're going to do immoral science.
Yeah, definitely.
Right? And if you're a democratic scientist, your science also will be democratic.
Yeah.
See, it's very simple. People tend to think of us as judging the subject of science. We're not judging the subject of science. In fact, I call it the Sita test, right? For me, science, the truth of science is called the Sita test. Everybody is thrown into this fire called the science. And if they burn, they are pure. It's like the witch's trial, right? So I call it the Sita test just after her. And if they're not pure, then they're not science. So you have to burn in science and be science, and then you're no longer there. You're absorbed into science. So if I have a scientific theory, if I have a philosophical theory that's very, very scientific, science will subject me to the science test, Sita test. And then science will burn me. Then I'm totally reducible to science. I become ashes, right? And then I am science now. I'm no longer philosophy. So science will not let me do philosophy. If I throw something into science and give it the science test, the epistemological science test, objectivity, whatever, and then it doesn't fulfill it, then they will throw me out saying, no, you're not science and you're not worth it also. So the problem with the science and morals is that scientists think that they are ateleological, that they have no purpose except for finding knowledge, right? Their ends may be ateleological, but their processes are not. So I at least have, in the past few days, I've spoken to so many of my humanities scholars, and everybody gave up biology, which they really love, because they couldn't catch cockroaches and frogs in their labs, right?
Yeah.
At a certain point of time, if science means only cutting up cockroaches and frogs, there are people who cannot do that. And does that mean they're not scientists?
Yeah.
Right? So it's like the discipline itself, it is not the science itself. Maybe the kind of science that was done in its early development. Now science has become very specialized. It's about mathematics, it's about reductionism. So the way science defines its boundaries is exclusive. And perhaps it can be, but the point is, at the time, what happens is they place themselves on a hierarchy of disciplines, right? Even in your, I don't know whether it's true in Jindal, but in a lot of university systems, tier one is engineering, tier two is science, tier three is humanities.
Yeah.
And your salary is given according to what you teach. And with the publish and perish kind of policy, scopus index. What does it mean? You know, I take 5 years and write this amazing book. I have to sit and translate one of the Sanskrit texts. I'm not able to go and publish in a scopus. Who's going to read that? You know, so it dilutes the purpose of philosophy. I have to write like philosophical management papers if I have to get published. Okay? Because it's a kind of stupidity that the science is making a power play, because I don't know. It's also being extra funded. They have money. They have everything. Just do your job. Leave us alone to do our job. Don't pull us into your, you know, don't put me on trial. Just let me go. I don't want to come to Ayodhya with you.
Which is why I think now, in most educational institutes as well as schools now, you have political science. It was at a time just politics or just political theory. It's now political
social
science and
social studies,
and now it's social sciences. Yeah.
And Dr. Sundar writes about this, right? He talks about how there was a movement where they tried to move. It is a European movement, but the thing is, even whether you're social science or science, scientists themselves are not involved. We haven't got a Nobel Prize in science, because the culture of our education is still authority based.
Yeah.
Even in science, they follow obedience. You see that?
Yeah. I think we rely too much on these authoritative testimonies, such as the Vedic testimony or the science.
So if Dr. So and so, some Dr. So and so has said, and you know, I tried arguing against what Amartya Sen said in a class. Forget Amartya Sen, even this new Homo sapiens book, I tried to argue against it, and they're like jumping up on me. I can't argue against any perceived, particularly male authority. And every Tom, Dick and Harry on the road is criticizing Romila Thapa for her historical work. I mean, look at the amount of work. So it's like, I don't think they will say, did they say the same thing to Amartya Sen that they would say to Romila Thapa? You can see the gender bias in that, right? So if so in one sense, I've become very cynical. If Romila Thapa, after so many years of amazing historical work, can still get criticized because she's a woman and they get away with it, it's like, where am I going to take my fight? I have to be really a Rani of Jhansi or something for that, you know? It's like that academic Rani of Jhansi have to be. But it's a hard fight, it's a hard fight. And if you notice, all philosophy departments have many women philosophers, right? Right now I can see you people are in Jindal. I have people in DU, there's a huge women philosopher. Jadavpur, there's a group of women philosophers. In Manipal University, there are two women philosophers, me and Mani Sachdev, we have philosophy teachers. Bangalore Central University, Kriya University, everywhere there are women philosopher groups. But we are not being given the power to influence the syllabus or change the face of philosophy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right? That, I think we are basically cooking. Point, yeah, that I wanted to ask you, that considering now that we have established that we are acknowledging the gender gap in philosophy, at least in Indian philosophical domain, then what do you think, what are the steps which can be taken to work on this gender gap? Is it only, can it only be solved when we are changing the curriculum, we are introducing more gendered voices, or do you think it has to be done on a very personal level as well, where we tell our students that don't see me as a mediator of what Wittgenstein has said. I am just not standing here with a chalk and a blackboard and telling you what Plato said. I am also a doctor who has given my 6-7 years in doing this book, and I want to talk about my perspective on what Plato has said. So men, irrespective of how much they are going to act as a mediator, they would always be philosopher. That, oh my goodness, he was so passionate and he gave a different turn to Marx and Hegel. He pretty much said what all interpretations have been saying, hello. And when a woman is saying it, it's like, oh yeah, she's a teacher. I mean, she's doing well. She's very analytical. It's just, you know, the same kind of interpretation which she's doing. And I'm like, okay, so how do we deal with this? What can we do to bridge the gender gap?
I think the day your channel is watched by male philosophers and they step back, that's the day we'll be able to, you know, we are all watching. I watched, right? My colleague watched. But which male philosopher has actually seen Dr. Bindupuri's interview, right? And the other thing that happens to us is in conferences, right? We get sidelined. I get sidelined to either an Indian philosophy, South Asian religion section, or I get sidelined to a gender section. So always, I mean, I have given the largest number of Women's Day lectures so far. Every year I have given a Women's Day lecture in philosophy. But when the lecture is about Mahabharata, when the lecture is about, pandemic, when the lecture is about the economics or freedom or will or Swaraj or what have you made, I have never been in fact, it's better in Europe now, right? All my intellectual lectures are being given in Europe. I give them to Germany. I talked about decoloniality in Germany. I talked about politics and nature in Germany. I talked about something else. But everywhere else, even the American Philosophical Association, I was in the gender section talking about Therigatha, women in philosophy. So that happens. So the day we, and it is important for us, because as women philosophers, till we get the stage, it maybe is important for us, but what happens is because we speak gender, we get confined to gender, right? We're not allowed to talk about other stuff. So and we end up being second in commands everywhere. I just checked that we're always second in command.
Yeah, is it so, also the case then that, you know, being specified or relegated to some specific field such as only gender or Indian philosophy, there's also a sense of exoticness, you know, involved. Like you mentioned that how is it that the Western world perceives of, you know, knowledge coming out of the Indian context? Is it not as critical or analytical as the Western philosophical world would like it to be? But they're still kind of recognizing, okay, you have this body of knowledge, but it's a little exotic for us, so we'll keep it to this domain on, like you mentioned, like either second in command, but we have like political philosophy here, or we have analytical Western philosophy tradition here, and that is what is in command as of now.
I think it's a power play. It's because when we are allowed into the mainstream philosophy, the mainstream philosophy, I like to call it, they're afraid they'll have to change. They're afraid of the change, right? The changes that women will bring. They're very critical of women in science because women are changing the way science is done, right? So the problem is not, it's about losing power and losing their authority, because now they have to sit back and learn new stuff. Right, they have to learn new stuff and learn new articulation. So it's like this: when my mom used to make chapati, she would give me one small piece of atta, and I won't say, I want to. They'll give me this atta and say, "Ye kar lo beta," and I'll make these little chapatis and keep playing, because I don't have to mess with the main cooking, right? Otherwise, I'll be messing with the main cooking. So like that, we are given this little like, okay, tum embroidery kar lo na, tum painting kar lo na, ye lo. And oh, bahut badhiya, how beautiful single. The first thing that I get appreciated for is how beautiful my hair is or how beautiful my clothes are. Most of the time, you look great on stage is the compliment I'd rather get, rather than saying that was a brilliant presentation. But what I think, what I see the perceiving is, as mentors, as a mentor, as a woman mentor, I push my women students. And when I push my women students, they're going one step ahead of me. And I'm not regretting that. Because as a woman, I know how hard it is to grow beyond your mentor, right? And so when my students go one step beyond me, I stand back and say, yes, go ahead, do your own paper. You don't need to refer back to me every time. You're your own authority. And as women, I think if we start modeling the male mentorship model, we have received male mentors. I have a male mentor. I'm sure all of you have had male mentors who let us be our philosophers, who really encouraged us. It's like we have good fathers in philosophy, right?
Yeah.
Not authoritarian, but a good father to look up to. Sad to use this family, but most of India is run like a family. Let's assume that. As a male mentor, then when you start mentoring your students, then you encourage them to break out and be their own thing, take risks, struggle with people, fight it out, and give them a helping hand when they need it, assist them in becoming philosophers. I think the mentorship, like this collective that we are forming, I mean, people have been, I know there's a Hindi collective of women philosophers. I don't know what they do. They just get along on Women's Day, and there's a huge, actually, parallel women philosophers organization with a Hindi name.
Oh,
it's there all over thing. My colleague was telling me, "Wo usme hum aapko jod denge." And basically, it's like
a
the Bletchley Circle, right? There's this whole pool of secretaries for philosophy who are doing this amazing work, and then feeding into their mentor programs.
Oh. That just takes me to something which I've been thinking, that every time when we talk about language, of course it's gendered, it's social in nature, and it's actually from language that the qualities are getting born into the real world. For instance, whether it's a quality of being an authoritative person, a person who has benevolence, a person who is a democratic person. Now, I remember, this is coming from a very lived experience, myself and a male philosopher, both of us were sharing the stage. It was like a roundtable conference which we were doing. And I started, because usually my teaching is very dialogue-based, so I told my students, the audience, that see, we would be co-host here, so you have to back me up. If I'm asking you, you have to respond. And I remember once the talk was over, the roundtable conference was over, few people, not on my face, but they said that I think she wasn't very sure what she was talking about, because who asked for dialogue? I mean, she's the speaker, right? She's supposed to just speak. Look at the male philosopher. How was he conducting himself? First thing. And second, the point is that every time, even in a classroom, when you are saying that I'm a democratic person, I would like to know the perspective of who is exactly my audience. What do you think? in most of the cases you come across as someone who's confused, who's not very sure about what she wants. अरे इतना क्यों पूछ रही है, इसको पता नहीं है क्या? At the same time, I remember when I was in JNU and the male philosophers used to, or the male professors used to do it, or everybody used to be in awe that, wow, man, look at him, he's so democratic and he believes in keeping everybody together. And I'm like, we were just trying to do it and you dismissed it by calling me confused. And that also makes me think that can we completely, like, for instance, now that it's been quite a few years that I've been doing public philosophy and feminist phenomenology, but the moment, as you also correctly said, the moment people say ki acha gender ki baat kar rahi hai, to kuch to serious itna hoga nahi. क्या ही बोलेगी, वही ऑटोनोमी की बात करेगी, थोड़ा बहुत बॉडी की बात करेगी, तो ठीक है तुम इस पैनल में रह के थोड़ा बहुत बोल लो, इट्स फाइन, दैट्स इट. बट हार्ड कोर फिलोसफी इज ऑलवेज लाइक, एज फ्यू ऑफ माई एक्विंटेंसेस वेरी प्राउडली से, सी आई एम एन आर्मचेयर इंटेलेक्चुअल, आई एम गोइंग टू सिट इन माई रूम एंड इन अ वेरी एब्स्ट्रैक्ट मैनर आई एम गोइंग टू टॉक, बट आई एम नॉट गोइंग टू टॉक टू पीपल. I'm not going to talk about lived experience. I'm not going to talk about embodiment. I'm not going to talk about social stratification. I am going to talk about what Kant has already talking about or talked about at some point of time. So I think something which I have been grappling during the pandemic on philosophy is philosophy only about talking what other philosophers have spoken at some point of time? Are we just like adding sand to the beach and saying, ha, Kant ne likha hai, bhai, 10-12 philosophers hi hai, right? Hum ghoom firke unke paas hi to aate hai. Or the fact that how elite, also the way initially when you said that the idea that philosophy is an elite discipline, it's the aristocratics discipline. So at the end of the day, I would not be considered an intellectual if I don't drop intellectual jargons of Sartre and Heidegger, and oh my God, I was reading Nietzsche, and I though even I couldn't understand, but I have to drop this name.
Yeah, name, so, dropping.
Name dropping. That's something which I tell my students all the time, that in 50 words, in ordinary language, you tell me what is this concept all about. Don't drop names. I know names. I know more names than you. You tell me in 50 words, and their concern is, in ordinary language, you want me to tell about philosophy. And I'm like, yeah. What is this? Like, unless and until there aren't 50, 20 thesaurus terms, I can do that. Tell me in ordinary language, what does this concept stand for? So do you think that there is also a power play between the language of philosophy, the authentic language of philosophy? In Indian philosophy, it has been Sanskrit, as you initially also pointed out. Do you think it also works in the way we are teaching philosophy right now, that we are teaching Indian minds from a Western perspective to think in a language which is not theirs, of course, and that to talk in a particular manner?
Yeah, I think it is true. And I think it's a crisis, not for only women philosophers, it's a crisis for philosophy. Philosophy is dying because of that, right? Because people will persist in, it's a battle against the syllabus and the curriculum also, in some sense. I've been lucky to work at an institute where we had our own curriculum we were able to formulate, and that was a brilliant success. It was so brilliant that other people felt jealous of us, and the whole program had to shut down. Philosophy program had to shut down in my MCPH became MCH now. Philosophy is gone, MA philosophy. But all of those products of that philosophy are philosophers today, women and men both. And they're all doing their PhD. So I'm so proud of that program, because we didn't do philosophy in the way that, so history of Western philosophy, pre-Socrates ke pehle ye mat padhana, iske baad ye padhana. So there's this whole history of philosophy, right? Conceptual thinking is missing. But actually, you know, this is an Indian problem. Philosophy is not taught this way. And when our students go abroad, they're like, philosophy class was amazing, because they were allowed to teach and articulate things like, somebody went and did philosophy of dark, they did theorization on darkness. The whole course was on darkness. Darkness from literature, darkness of Sartre, darkness of existentialism. Imagine a course on darkness. Now, if I suggest this course, neither my university nor the UGC are going to understand what I'm doing, right? Because they understand philosophy as content. That is the problem. If they understand philosophy as thinking, I can take a bottle and do the entire course on the bottle and my philosophy will be done. So I think in the classroom, we can break out and you can do what you say. But I think slowly, I think over years, students will start to appreciate what you're doing, right? Because constantly what happens is, that's why I started the Mistress of Philosophy channel, right? That was my aim, to tell people that philosophy doesn't have to be like this elite language business. It's good to, I think what happens is they don't understand that thoughts are very, philosophical thoughts are abstract. So the confusion between abstract and high-flown language. The reason we feel philosophy is high-flown is because we're reading translations of German philosophy. If you listen to Kant in German, he is not that high-flown. But when you try and translate something, it becomes very high-flown. Like saying, if you say Kajal, it's very simple. It is a corellium of the eye or something like that, black corellium or whatever. It becomes really black eyeliner made with charcoal. After a due process of purification. That's science, right? So the language makes it so, you know, it's a stupid, Osho used to call it something, he used to call it intellectual masturbation. You yeah. stroke.
Through language,
I shouldn't say this publicly, but I hope all the people watching the channel are adults. But that's exactly what you're doing. You're getting, without the actual reality of getting pleasure, you're just getting some kind of pleasure, right? Of this, it's good. If you want to do that, do literature. Yeah, it's got a lot of problem. It's got a lot of scope for that. You can just go fun, have fun with language. But and also again, it's power, right? You want to. Every student ever, first class, Nietzsche. I'm like, first to Aristotle, then we'll come to Nietzsche.
Yeah.
You know, just understand one. And so that's the whole thing. And even when I was teaching Indian philosophy, by chance, I was doing this whole Indian philosophy. I wanted the students to get interested. As I was talking about Akka Mahadevi, Gargi, I always include everyone in that. Okay. And I was talking about Buddha, Nagarjuna, Abhinavagupta. I, by chance, went a little far, had a little storytelling of Kanada Kashyapa, right? The Vaisheshika person, Uluka, who used to stay and was like sociopathic and all. Suddenly everybody is his, they become the hero. Kanada Kashyapa becomes a hero because he's a typical philosopher. He's eccentric, he's mad, he eats grains and he's sociopathic, he doesn't go with people. So they're just waiting for a male model philosopher
to come in,
right? They're just waiting for that dadi wala. So I think it requires a revolution for them to forget. I mean, it's also the question that male members have been in so much leadership all over. There's so much male models. Even our prime minister is growing a beard. So male model philosophers are so much that. First of all, there is a beard. Second of all, there's an age. Third of all, there's a white. So if you put a white man with beard and a and an Indian brown man with beard and a black man with beard,
then
there's another kind of thing. You put a clean-shaven man and a older bearded man, there's another kind of. So it's like this stereotype of the bearded man. It's fun. It's all very fun. I can wear a beard and come turn up in class and just give them that idea. But it doesn't change the fundamental, foundational, patriarchal upbringing that they've had, right? So it's interesting that in school, you should notice this. In school, your miss is authority.
Yeah.
Against your mother and father and everybody. So if miss says something, the children are like, miss is authority. Somewhere between school and college, that authority figure changes from miss to this mister.
Yeah, because most, and that's also the case, most teachers were the females were most teachers in elementary schools or as you're growing up.
So you should think that being trained by so many women in their elementary school and high school, they would continue to see women as epistemic authority. So I'm thinking that we actually have to think what happens between the school and the college to flip that equation into male authority. Is it that the college becomes a space of so much confusion and so much of difficulty that they want a male authority to hold them. They want a papa to solve all their problems. Is it that? Or I don't know where. I mean, I think we should actually, as philosophers, seriously look at what happens to the flip. You know, where ma'am is the authority and suddenly...
And suddenly then it's and at professor level, you need it as a male professor.
You need it as a male professor. So you should think about that.
Yeah. Definitely, and thanks for that, Meera. I think we're nearing the end of our session also. It was quite an interesting conversation, and you touched upon a lot of these relevant themes. You know, I'm now going to be thinking about this fact, right? Like towards the end, you mentioned like how at the formative elementary level, the miss is the authority, yet at some stage later in life, we move on or transition into having or seeking out a male authority at higher academic level. And also the fact that I believe in that, like how women philosophers will be addressed, they'll be addressed as teachers of philosophy and not necessarily just, you know, she is a philosopher, right? And I'm sure you're one of them, right? Like you have your own YouTube blog with the Mistress of Philosophy channel, right? So it's nice to have you put yourself and your thoughts out there. And, you know, it's interesting to see how you play around with the language in the name of the channel as well. Whether it's, I mean, it may just be for getting an audience, but the fact that they get hooked on with the name itself, the Mistress of Philosophy, you may have used language there to your benefit, but they'll probably get
it. Is a very strong political statement, right?
Yeah.
So as I'm discussing with you, it's a whole thing about being a wife of philosophy, right? If I just call it like, I want to give myself the centrality in that channel, right? Yeah. So it's a kind of, every time I've been told, whenever I used to present myself as, I'm a philosopher, people used to come back and say, you're very arrogant. For a woman. They don't say that, but that's there in the bracket, right? You don't push yourself. So when I see my colleagues introducing themselves, I have written this book, I'm the hell. When they do it, it seems natural and okay. Yeah. But when I go forward and say, I'm running a channel, I've written 4 books, I'm doing the Scopus Index paper, I can do this, I can do that, they're like, you can do this also.
And then you'll also be like, they'll term you like a diva also, if you throw some tantrum. They'll be like, what a diva?
Diva only. I'm already that. So I decided I'm already a diva. So because I draw, I paint, I compose, I write, I do poetry, I do painting, I do craft work, I do embroidery, I can sew my own clothes, I can knit my own clothes. Except for crocheting, I run my own blog, I can run a website, I have mentored so many students, I can talk out of the hat without even preparation. I've studied all the books that I have, I can do Sanskrit, I have 5 languages under my belt. What else can you do? Oh my God, is it not enough? You woman, just sit and cook your food. Can you also cook? Yes, I cook. I prefer not to cook. And like, see?
You can't do that.
And do you have children? No, I don't have children. Oh, see? You scored points again. So it's like so pissed off. And I said, I don't want to be a wife of philosophy. I want to be a mistress because I want to have a subversive relation. And I want to do philosophy on that channel, which is completely wrong. So if my professor,
this notion of having like a pure philosophy, like what is the notion of purity in how is it that you practice philosophy?
If any of my teachers, see my channel, they're going to like, oh shit, what did we teach her? You know, she's doing everything wrong in that, right? So I'm doing everything wrong in that. I'm just going out and on a limb and saying what I like, when I like, how I like, right? Just freewheeling it out through the... I hardly prepare the script. I have the theme and then I go rattling. I need better editing skills. Even on barefoot, that's the joy I have. I can write about a chappal and be happy. Basically, I'm doing what Kenny Sebastian would do on his stand-up comedy. Talk about anything philosophically and see where it takes me. And I hope that there are more mistresses of philosophy. I think the internet is allowing us a channel where we can put across our views without being, without the male gaze. You know, the male gaze is, it can be there. There have been some pompous comments on my philosophy, especially when I talk about caste and stuff. You're going to get that. But I think somewhere I feel sometimes I have a breakthrough. Sometimes. There are these little glimmers of hope where people come and tell back, come and tell me that the kind of way you taught me philosophy, and since you both are young teachers right now, you won't experience that right away. But I promise you, in a couple of years, some of your students will come back and tell you the way you taught me philosophy is what led me to do real philosophy. So that's coming. When it comes, you'll feel really fulfilled. And if you've got that in about 5 or 6 voices in your students, you'll feel really fulfilled, right?
That's good
and
to hear.
And marginalize, it's not marginalization as much as it is being walked off the stage. In a meeting, you're walked off the stage. Like, somebody will always upstage you. You're saying something, and you will find this also, be very careful as women philosophers, I would say, that when you're talking and you give out an idea, like you're just talking in a meeting and you give out the idea, suddenly a male professor will actually repeat your idea, and then they won't remember you are the originator of the idea. The credit will go to the male, though it was your original idea. And then you go on shouting, it was mine. It's like, nahin, nahin, par aapka to pehle tha na, usne usko achha bana diya baad mein.
Like explained it, articulated it.
So it's like...
Made it more theoretical in nature.
Theoretical, yeah.
It was more theoretical when it came from his perspective.
I think that's exactly what happened to all the women philosophers. Women philosophers will be talking and discussing trees and cows and pramana and everything. I'm sure they were discussing it. And this male fellow sitting there, tumhe pata nahi hai main theek se likhta hun. So they were basically editors. So I have decided that all old male philosophers were editors. Except the sannyasis, I don't see how they could have got access to a woman. But let's see. Yeah.
But you never know, like...
You never know the stories. So I decided that since we don't have... That's another thing that you people should do. You should write fiction about women philosophers.
That'd be interesting.
Imagine old women philosophers. I've already written one book.
Like a conversation. Imagine what are they talking or discussing?
And just in the fictional thing, since everybody is claiming she... was in Tibet and they're making a success of their story. You can definitely have Shankara go to a woman teacher, learn everything, and then chuck her out and make his own Advaita. It's quite possible. You can do that.
Yeah.
Nobody will care.
I mean, as long as it's fictional, I mean, that's the...
You write a fiction. Yeah. I think that imagination will, like for in the case of the LGBTQ movement, that kind of imagination will transform people's stereotyping. Because Harry Potter lives much more alive than, you know, Sulabha.
Yeah.
So if you turn Sulabha into a Harry Potter, she will live a more stronger in people's life. Who was Sulabha? Where was she before? Where was she after? Nobody knows. Write a novel on Sulabha. Simple.
Yeah, that's true. And
we won't find her story, right? We won't find it.
Yeah.
I mean, we can't go back in time and find. So write a very powerful fictional woman.
I think, yeah.
The Africans are doing it.
Yeah. And that's a good thing as well. That I mean, we can have a discussion around that as well. African philosophy and the body of knowledge that comes out of the African continent itself is interesting to see. And I'm glad at some stage in my life, I've been able to, you know, expose myself to literature from that part of the world as well. And it's not just Western or Indian philosophy. There's not just that. But so now, thank you, Meera, for joining us today. And it was a very vibrant discussion. And I'm glad we got to cover various themes and as well as the relevant areas of interest as well. Any last thoughts or suggestions for young researchers or people who would be willing to, you know, take on this journey or wishing to pursue philosophy further, young researchers or academics or anything? What would be your advice or suggestion to them?
Oh, whenever you're down with gender and philosophy and stuff, call a friend. call your women philosophers, right? You know, in at least in a network, we should start doing that. That's, I think that's the main thing. You just call a friend. And I think right now, artificially, I think women should not put other women down right now. Even if we feel our friends, what philosophy they're doing is not good and it's not up to the mark or something. I think right now, the way it is going, it doesn't matter.
Encouragement.
Yeah, because the kind of battle, we're fighting battle on three levels. We're fighting battle with the family and the academic situation, like just being academics. Yeah. Uncles and aunts will come and say, what are you doing? And then we're fighting battles at the institutional level, yeah, where we are fighting for equality and expression. We're fighting an intellectual battle of establishing ourselves as Indian philosophers. We're fighting epistemic battles within our own self, trying to do, we battle with our own subject, yeah, right? We're trying to figure out and write and read. So, and then the ultimate battle is we're constantly being confronted with inequality as a woman, even if you're not a philosopher. We have the normal gender battle.
Yeah, definitely.
That we are fighting on behalf of other women also. Forget women philosophers.
Yeah.
We're fighting for LGBTQ, we're fighting for women, women's rights and stuff. So in that sense, the women philosopher in India is like almost like Jhansi Rani. She's fighting so many battles. Mata Hari's we are. You know, so because we are aware of politics, we are aware of sociology. I think that is why our lives are more complicated. I mean, we're just not women's rights activists. We're also epistemic battlers, right?
Yeah.
So it's a weird place. So call a friend. That's the best advice I can give, because most of the time we tend to look, I've seen women philosophers. When you have a network like this, I think that's very important what you both have done, because I think the point of the network would not only be to, like, you know, put ourselves in the foreground as women philosophers, but also look at how we can pick up the phone and talk, or just the kind of discussion we had today. I didn't want it to be like a lecture, but you people came out with your own experiences. And I think if you can organize a conclave of every one of us complaining at the same time, those of us, we need to tell people how to handle these situations.
Yeah.
Right? What do we do? So there are some kinds of, you know, this is what happened to me in a conference, and this is how I handled it. And this worked, this didn't work. Can we do this? So I think you need to have a conclave of complaining women voices, and then we need to talk to each other and bhadas nikal dena.
Yeah.
And that's why I believe maybe we have reached at a place where we can see that ranting and complaining are just not form of catharsis. They also form part of your pedagogy. They also become of
it's our tradition.
to tell that, see, I'm just not like complaining. I'm telling you this is what has happened.
Yeah,
how have I experienced it? That entire phase, how it was. And also shout out to people who are listening to us. But see, if it's happening, if it happened to you yesterday, you are not alone.
No.
It happened to me 20 years back also. So it's just the characters which are changing.
Yeah.
The story maybe remains the same.
So I think that tells you that you're not alone, right? And as women philosophers, the first experience of mine was I was very lonely. I was like, koi nahi hai yaar.
Yeah.
And environmental philosophy, nobody was doing at that point of time. I was like, koi nahi hai yaar. And the person who was there, who was a woman philosopher, who was with us, was like very spiritual. And you're like, you're married and you corrupted your soul. And so I was like, she was from that authority. And I was like feeling even more lonely. And I was like, I had like a mad mentor. And I was like, what should I do? You know?
Yeah, I think that feeling of that collectiveness, you know, that you can share your experiences with the other counterparts who are sharing that same similar journey with you. I think that's important.
And also, I think what you should also do in your collective is to not make the senior professor and the junior professor difference, right?
The hierarchy.
I found that at a particular point of time, like, for example, you both are philosophers in your own right. You should do your own interviews.
Yeah.
Right? Maybe I'll interview you. I don't know. Yeah. I think what I've continuously seen is that the PhD students become one conclave. The very, all of us, like me and Bindu Puri, we become like these professors who are in some pedestal and we are alone. And then there are you people who are just new philosophers just finished PhD who are in 4-5 years into work and not yet made to the associate, but hanging around the assistant, you feel like a conclave. And so these generations are not meeting.
Concept of thinking.
For people who live in their head so much, it is better that they have a place where they know that there are other people who are as. And it also helps, you take on one eccentric physical characteristic, and that helps to ward off this, you're not a philosopher thing, right? I wear hats. Yeah. I wear hats outside. A lot of women academics are wearing hat, because that makes that eccentricity come without losing our finesse for lipstick and bindis, right? So I wear hats. Another philosopher friend of mine has, a lot of philosophers have this big bindi business going on. So it's just to keep these people's mouths shut. It's not to comply with what they're saying, but it's just, I'm so fed up of hearing that, like, you don't look like a philosopher.
Yeah, so right? Probably having your own physical trait.
Some quirk you have. You have one big nose ring or something. I don't know. It's like just the way the LGBTQ kind of forward their identity. Quirkiness is supposed to be associated with philosophy. I don't mind quirkiness. So I think quirkiness works. But I think if you do that, then again, you're excluding people who are doing philosophy without being philosophers.
Yeah, and there are practicing philosophers who may not be academics.
Yeah, there are. Yeah. So but for you in the class itself, it helps to have a quirky behavior, just to shut up the male philosophers.
So probably we'll take that in mind. Let's see if that works.
If that works. It's just like unnecessarily putting the word mistress in the channel.
Yeah.
Right? It's like that.
So, yes, definitely. Thank you so much, Meera. And thank you, Richa, as well. This was a great discussion. And we shall touch base soon on future projects or conversations or work together in collaboration. That'll be good as well. And thank you so much. And we look forward
to meeting with you. Yeah, one suggestion. So, well, last time also for Bindupuri's lecture and mine, we mentioned writings and people, right? If it would be nice if you put a small little book list at the bottom of the video. Authors you mentioned, that'll be a good thing. There are these extremely intellectual philosophers, like, where can I get that book? What book did she mention? So just search.
Yeah, like a brief, like a summary recap of
Not the summary, but the books that we mentioned.
Oh, yeah, the text. Yeah, the text and the authors.
The text is like, cite the text. Yeah.
I think that's a good point. Like, people can take up references from there as well.
And that would be creating a good database as well.
Yeah,
that's true.
Thank you, Meera.
Sure. Thank you, Meera. And have a good day. Same to you, Richa. Thank you.
Go forth and philosophize, girls.